Hi. Hi, Cindy. Hi, everyone. My name is Vivian. Vivisaurus, for people who use Duolingo. And Dr. Cindy Blanco has joined me today to answer questions from our community about staying at home, teaching. Hi, everybody. I see your chat. There are people joining us from everywhere. Hi, Cindy. How are you?
Hi, Vivian. I'm good. I'm all right. How are you?
I'm good. We're all working from home. We have a range of people living in Pittsburgh here, and people all over the world working for Duolingo who have challenges that are different everywhere. And we've heard a lot from parents and teachers and people who are learning languages themselves who really want to know more about how to use Duolingo in the classroom, not in the classroom, but the remote classroom, or at home, or if they're now the teachers, as parents, how they can help their children learn. So we asked them to send us their questions, and I think you've seen some of them?
Yes, yeah, I've been kind of obsessively reading them, but yeah, I have them here in front of me.
Okay. My Facebook logged me out, so I am logging back in. Sorry about that. Okay. So, do you want to start? I'm going to actually show Duolingo behind me because that might help people see. I have my account open. It might help people see what we're talking about, illustrate our answers a little better. What do you want to start with? Does anyone in the chat have any questions yet? How are you all doing? Okay, I am going to start with one that I saw. I do remember that I saw one about sentences. Did you see that one? About, with Duolingo. First of all, a lot of our questions seem to be feedback. And that is, it's hard to answer most feedback. It's just like, can you add this language? Can you change the color of this? And the both of us probably can't just say we're going to do it, but we are here to hear your feedback too.
I mean, so there's, I felt like when I looked at the questions that there were like many common threads that I hope we get to touch on today. So there were a lot of questions about like new courses and new languages, and Vivian, I know you especially know a lot about that process. I hope that maybe even if we don't get to answer everybody's like exact question, like I think we should definitely talk about learning strategies.
Of course,
there are lots of questions about like tips and grammatical explanations, but there's a lot of new things that we can say about that. I do want to talk about a little bit about new courses and how that happens and why sometimes it feels like not happening as fast as we would like. There's always questions about hearts and leaderboards. We have lots of things we can say about that.
Okay. Why don't we start talking about new languages and when is my favorite language coming to Duolingo?
Yeah. So I'll start a little bit, but Vivian, really, you're more the expert here, is that we have this, what we call Duolingo Incubator, incubator.duolingo.com, and that's where all of our new baby courses are being nurtured into being. And if you have an idea for a new course or you'd like to contribute to a new course, you can apply there. And so what happens is that we have really limited resources to start brand new courses. And so when we're deciding which new courses to pursue, we think about what kind of engineering, but also teaching resources that we have available. Do we have applications from a group of people, right? We wouldn't want the pressure. I mean, it's a lot of work to create a course. And so we want to make sure that we create a team of people that can create a course, not just one or two people. That's not really fair to them. And so we look for languages that we can create a team of people, maybe who have teaching backgrounds or are bilingual in the languages. And so we keep track there of what languages we have people in the community who are interested in working on until we can create a good team of people to ensure the success of the course. Say more, Vivian.
No, it's right. We carefully select every person who's going to be like the seed of that team that's going to start the course, and we want to make sure they're the very best. And we also need people who can dedicate time, because this is something that they volunteer to do. They want to share their language with the world for free, and it is a tricky process, and also, you know, takes resources from us, so we have to make sure that we have enough staff to support the new courses that are starting. So it is a little slow, but we have so many courses. You can explore our courses page, and we have a lot that are coming that we haven't announced yet. So chances are your course is coming, but we can't promise when.
I know there was a specific question about Quiche. That's a Mayan language in Mexico, about what the timeline is there. And it looks like right now that will be released probably early next year, or that's what we're on track right now. That's sometime about a year from now. Because that's about how long it takes to create like a long enough course that we would offer people.
Yeah, and I think I saw a lot of people asking, this is a very common question, when are we going to get this specific Spanish? Can you say more about that? Like, why can't I learn Spanish from Spain?
Yeah. So this is a question I know a lot about. My Spanish is more European Spanish than it is Latin American, so I get it, everyone. When we are creating a course, especially for a language like Spanish that's spoken as an official language in like 21 or 23 countries, something like that, this is an enormous population of Spanish speakers. And so we do have to make some hard decisions about what variety we'll teach and even like what particular words that we'll teach. With the example of Spanish, what we do is think about where most of our learners are, and so what will serve them best. And for Spanish, we've chosen Latin American Spanish, and whenever we really are pushed to make some kind of decision about words or grammar, we'll often pick Mexican Spanish, because there are so many Mexican Spanish speakers that we feel like that will probably serve most of our learners best. For Spanish, I think it's also important to point out that if you learn European Spanish, you will be understood. I mean, 95-99% you'll be understood in Latin America. And the same is true the other way around, that if you study Latin American Spanish, 99% of what you would say in Spain would be understood. There's a lot of vocabulary differences throughout Latin America, also throughout Spain. And so I think as a learner, it's most important to think about like setting a really solid foundation to be able to express yourself, because you'll always encounter new words and phrases. You know, even if you studied exclusively Mexican Spanish, there'll be lots of towns and places in Mexico where you'll encounter new words or new expressions. And that's true even, you know, for me as an English speaker in English, you encounter new things. I moved to Pittsburgh a couple years ago, and there's new expressions here that I had to figure out, even as a native English speaker. And so for something like Spanish, I think we're looking at including more resources to get people in front of new kinds of language, like with the stories and the Spanish podcast. And so I think you can get a really solid foundation from this one single Spanish course, and then use some other resources like our Duolingo podcast to hear more peninsular European Spanish.
Yeah, that's great. I think we should move on to these so many questions we got from Facebook comments yesterday. One was, somebody wanted some tips, some good sources to use after completing the tree. So the tree is what the courses, like this this whole thing is what we call the tree. So after you finish it and you get to your little trophy, I think I got a trophy in this one. Okay, I didn't. What can you do to expand your knowledge and get better?
Yeah, so there's a couple pieces of advice that I would give. One is to find, there's other things that you could do on Duolingo, like the podcast. Like I said, if you're someone who's studying Spanish or French, I think that's a really good way to hear new accents, to learn more about the culture and people's daily lives. But as a general language learning tool, I would say that you should find ways that you already enjoy language in your life and incorporate your second language there. So if you're someone who loves TV or movies, start either watching movies from that target language, from that target country, in the language, probably with subtitles at the beginning. If you're someone who really enjoys podcasts or music, find music in the language that you're learning. If you like to read, something that I like to do, especially when I was less proficient, would be to find books in the language I was learning, but that were already things I was familiar with. So, right, I read Harry Potter, and I really enjoyed then reading Harry Potter in Spanish because I already knew the plot, I already knew the characters, mm-hmm. and so I could really focus on developing more language skills, like who knew what the Spanish word was for the magic wand. That didn't come up in any class I ever took. But there you can kind of enjoy the language without having to, like, stress about, like I said, plot or characters. You know what's going to happen, and so I think that's a really good way. Incorporate the language that you're studying into the things you already love doing. I think that is really good for motivation, and it's certainly good for learning.
Yeah. Somebody also said, related to that, isn't the perfect way to learn and practice language by talking to a native speaker? Would Duolingo consider that as an option in the long run? I want to add that we do have, although it's kind of on pause, we do have Duolingo events, which is when you feel like you want to practice with real people.
You're switching to online. Aren't there a lot of online events now?
Well, yes. I think some, I should explain what events are first. But yes, I think some people during this corona situation are switching to online on their own. I think they're getting creative. But events is events.duolingo.com. You can go in there and you can see somebody in your town is hosting an event, French events, to practice French, for example. And if nobody is, you can apply to become a host. And these people meet in coffee shops, libraries, and just practice. And often there are native speakers in there. So that's a really good way to take the next step. Doing that parallel to your Duolingo tree is really cool. People make friends. And yeah, I think it's a really good way. But yeah, a reminder that the in-person events are on hold. But there are some people who are branching out to online. So maybe if your town doesn't have anything, you still have an option to attend an event that's remote. Did you see any questions that stuck out to you that you wanted to address?
Can I add something there from kind of like the learning science perspective about the native speaker?
Of course.
Is that like the best, I mean, certainly the best way to learn is that you want to get in front of accessible language that's rooted in meaning, right? And so, right, meaningful context, whether that's books or, you know, spoken language, and so native speakers can be really good for that. But I think what's more important is that you're interacting with the language in a way that is accessible. And so, right, it's not enough to have, like, you know, ongoing conversation with one single native speaker. That could be really good. But I think we've probably all had experiences with other languages where we wish the person would, like, slow down more or use simpler words or simpler grammar. And so if you can't get language that's, like, a good fit for you, that makes it really, really hard to learn from, right? Like, kids have it easy that kids have all of these grown-ups around them who, like, speak slower and really exaggerated and repeat words a lot. And so they hear lots of repetition, they hear lots of simple speech, they hear lots of things that are really well suited for their learning. And that's harder to get as an adult. And so it could be that a native speaker is a good solution. It could be that a non-native speaker is a good solution. And I think for any kind of learning, you want to get yourself in front of language that's a really good fit for you. Which is why that's been a motivation in how we design the courses, that they start ideally with, like, basic accessible vocabulary, really practical things, and move to more advanced levels.
Great. We got a person who asked three questions that I think we can, four, in one. I think we can tackle. The first one is, would you consider changing the examples to more useful sentences that would be used in real life situations? So Duolingo is known for having quirky sentences like the dolphin lost its keys, all of those, you know. I don't know, I want to hear your perspective on that. I think what I usually tell people is that Duolingo has this method of teaching you, it's like building blocks. So we teach you these, how to construct sentences, and it doesn't matter who the character is that lost its keys. You can replace that character. So instead of teaching you to memorize sentences, you're just going to repeat. Like, I'm not going to memorize, like, how do I get a cab? Where's the library? We're just going to say, you know, where is this? And then you can replace the words you need to replace for whatever you need. So that's what I usually say when people ask about the quirky sentences. And I think there's also something to say about quirky sentences being more memorable and helping you remember things. So I would love your perspective.
Yeah, so I really like the building blocks and analogy that you made there, Vivian. So learning a language is not memorizing sentences. It's easy to think of it like that, but language is actually a lot more creative, especially if you think about going into these contexts like traveling or studying in a new country in a new language, that you are constantly encountering brand new sentences, brand new words, brand new speakers, that you can't ever get by with just memorizing some sentences. And so we don't want to encourage you to just kind of blandly memorize sentences. And so Vivian, you're exactly right that we want you to like build this system, this structure for language where you can fill in new words or new verbs and like you have the flexibility to encounter any kind of sentence. I think the quirky sentences are fun. I don't think language learning has to be dry. I think it can be silly and it can include silly things like, you know, the bear drank my beer or like the dolphin and the keys. Things can be fun and still be really useful for learning. We want you to build a language structure. We don't want you to memorize some set list of sentences. We want you to be able to use the language in real contexts.
Yeah.
Can I add one more thing about the structure of the courses? Because I think it was, I'm not sure if it's in this set of questions or someone else's set of questions, bringing up the kind of these quirky, these fun sentences and how useful are they? And so one thing we're doing right now that's already happened on our biggest courses on Spanish and French and the English courses, some of the English courses, and now we're expanding is that we are updating the courses to align them with some international standards for language learning. So we're looking at the CEFR, which is the European standard for language proficiency, and we're updating our courses so that they're really well aligned with these international standards. And so these standards set out goals for beginners, goals for intermediate learners, and we're updating to make sure that we're really prioritizing the most useful grammar and vocabulary early in the course, and that things get that as you continue through the course, that you're reaching the higher goals outlined by the international standard. But again, we can still have these like fun, silly sentences that are targeting the most important vocabulary and the most important grammar. Right? Language learning doesn't have to be dry.
No, that's why we stick with it, right? That's one of the reasons people stick with Duolingo too. It's just, it's not something that gets tiring, at least for me. Is there any possibility to return to the old system of clubs instead of the leagues? I don't think it has to be one or the other. I think that the benefits of clubs is something that we are aware of and we are looking into. But we don't have to remove one to get the other, I think.
The thing that I would add there about these leagues, sometimes they're called leaderboards, is that we know that language and learning is social, that people want to interact with other people. And I think we're all really sensitive to that now that we're isolated at home. Like, we really miss being with other people. And so we rolled out the leaderboards, maybe was it like a year ago?
Yeah.
Maybe not quite that long, almost a year ago, as like a new version. And so the way we think about all new products and features at Duolingo is that we're constantly improving them and updating and rethinking them. And so I think leaderboards are a really promising way to get people engaged and coming back to their lessons. But the way that you see them now isn't the way they'll be forever. We're always thinking about ways to make them more engaging or more fun, make them a better fit for learning. This is an ongoing process, and so this is the version that you see now is only going to get better. Nothing is ever finished. We don't ever like thinking of products or learning as being finished, and so it's ongoing for us too. Things are going to keep. We're going to try out lots of new things. I know there's lots of experiments happening around leaderboards right now.
There's a lot of. I was going to go back to that question, but there's a lot of conversation going on in the chat about people judging my tree for me not finishing all to level 5 before I move on.
Oh, good.
So, actually, this is an old tree. I haven't touched the Portuguese tree for a little while. But what do you think about that? Like, people are sharing their methods. Do you think I should have leveled up all of my skills to level 5? So this is the level. There's a little 1 or 2 in these crowns by every circle. And you can level all of them up to 5, which is when they turn gold. Or you can just unlock to level 1 and just move on, right? And people have different ways of doing it. What do you think?
So I have written about this on the Duolingo blog. So if you go to blog.duolingo.com, and you can search for, you could scroll back probably, but you could also search for what we're calling the hover method, that you hover. I think the best way for learning is to hover around a group of those circles, a group of those units. And so always mixing learning new material with learning old material. So what I would say is that it's not best for learning to take one circle, get it all the way to level 5, and then move on. And then do the next circle all the way to level 5, and then move on to the all the way to level 5. What you want to do is more of a mix. So, on today, for example, maybe I would do some lessons in a brand new circle and a lesson or two in a circle that I did yesterday. And then tomorrow, I would do some new lessons and some lessons from today's circle and some lessons from yesterday's circle, and so that you're constantly mixing old and new. And I think this is more engaging, for one thing, that like you're not focused on the same vocabulary words like over and over and over again until you reach the end of the unit, but it's also better for learning that it helps you build connections across all of the different material at once, that you want to be seeing new and seeing old. It's important to note that in each of those unit circles, as you get to higher levels, we transition away from the easier exercises and get to more difficult exercises, more speaking and listening, more translating into the language that you're learning. And so things get a lot tougher as you get to level 5. But I would recommend that hover method that you can read about on the blog so that you're working on a group of circles at the same time. In general, Vivian,
yes.
If you use the language that you're learning, you probably do want to get up to level 5 as you go. You don't want to only reach level 1, and we have some new data showing that that doesn't lead to very good learning, only getting that basic introduction. You want to practice those other skills, the listening and the speaking, and going in that harder direction, typing more in your new language, but that's better for learning. So you should work on leveling
so
up.
Is it bad for me to finish the tree on level 1 and then do the whole thing in 2 and then the whole thing in 3? Because I know some people get a little bit annoyed by doing the same, especially in the basic skills, doing that over and over.
Yeah, I would not recommend that, going through the whole tree one level at a time. I think focusing on small sections and getting them, working on a small section at a time and gradually like hovering down the tree, that's much better than kind of doing everything to 1 and everything to 2.
Okay.
Yeah, don't leave listening and speaking till the end. Those are really important too. Get to those levels. Get to level 3 and level 4.
Yeah. Okay, we have another one that says, I know it's a bit against the Duolingo philosophy, but have you considered doing a separate section of quizzes on the rules of grammar, a bit like what's done with words? Also, any word on Duo Stories in other languages like French and German?
Oh, French and German?
Yeah. Hang on a minute.
So we have stories available
Sort of stories, so people know what we're talking about.
in French, German, Portuguese, and Spanish for English speakers. So maybe they meant from other language backgrounds.
Not sure.
We do have lots of big plans for stories this year in the next few months, and I'm not allowed to talk about them. But stay tuned. We are thinking about ways that we can bring more stories to our learners. What was the other part of the question?
The quizzes. Hang on, let me find
Oh,
it.
okay, so grammar. Yeah, okay, so focusing on like grammar quizzes, if that was the idea.
Yeah.
So there are some new experiments that are just starting, or maybe just about to start, in the French course that we're going to be experimenting with new ways to introduce and teach grammar. And if you're someone who's been studying French in the French course with us, you might have seen some of these experiments already. I saw some questions in the comments earlier about like getting grammatical information in the lesson itself. So right now, and Vivian, maybe you can show this. I can't see your screen, so I'll just
Okay.
trust you. That you can, a lot of our courses have grammatical and pronunciation and vocabulary tips that before, after you do a lesson, you can read about some of the topics that are covered in that lesson. And so we are also taking some of those grammatical tidbits and putting them in the lessons. And so maybe, I know I was getting them sometimes in French, that if you make a mistake in the middle of your lessons, like let's say you mistype a verb, you use the wrong ending, that you'll get a little lesson, a little tip right in the middle that says, hey, you made this mistake, or you have to remember this other thing about French, and it'll kind of like show you the correction right there as soon as you made the mistake. So we are experimenting with that. We're figuring out what kinds of grammatical tips are most useful for our learners. What are the most common kinds of mistakes? We are definitely thinking about new ways to get learners like up to speed on grammar. We know that this is really important, and there's a lot of new things coming. Especially, we do a lot of experimentation in general at Duolingo. Right now, I know those grammar features are being experimented with in the French course, and we see how they go. We figure out what works. We figure out what we want to do differently. And when we land on something we really like, then we'll expand it to the other courses.
Okay, and somebody had an interesting, very Cindy question here that I hope you can help me answer. Where is it? Explain what all the different things are at the beginning. In German, there's dative, nominative, accusative, modal, etc. I've been learning German for 265 days, and I still have
Oh, that's amazing.
no clue what those tenses mean.
So I love a good noun case system. We've talked about this all afternoon. A couple things. One of the things is that for German, you can look at those tips that I just mentioned, kind of before, after doing a lesson, and see some of the information there about when those different cases are used, what the endings look like. I would also say though that to be that it's not necessary to like know all the grammatical terminology to learn a language or to learn a language well. And so it sounds like that learner has already encountered these terms, dative, nominative, accusative. Maybe I know there's some really great grammatical information on our website that is a little bit different from what you'll see in the app. Maybe they've searched kind of elsewhere for that. You don't have to know everything about nominative or what it is or when it's used in order to use nominative well. You can still get that from the course itself. And actually, German is one of these courses that we're currently updating to align with those European proficiency standards. That is happening right now as we speak. We're hoping to roll that out, I think, in the next quarter. So that is happening. One of those experiments that's happening in the French course that, again, like if it goes really well, we'll expand it to other courses, is a place where all of that kind of grammatical information could live, like a searchable database, like a browsable kind of language guide, like a grammar guide that could live right there in the app. So if you are a learner who wants to know about nominative, accusative, and dative, and I'm that kind of learner too, that I really like, what a surprise, I'm a learning scientist, I really like that kind of language information, that there could be a place in the app where we explain that kind of top to bottom, what is going on in the language there. So stay tuned. We are thinking about other ways to get that information for the users who do want to see it.
Thank you very much. Thank you for joining us, everybody. We have way more questions than we can handle right now. I think we're probably going to do this again.
Yeah, let's do it again, because I do want to answer about hearts, too. I think there's some good things that we can say about hearts, and I know that that's something that came up a lot in the questions.
Yes. And I see Leek's questions coming up in the chat as well. We have a lot to answer, but we have to finish because we're like a few minutes over. But thank you, Cindy, for joining us. And stay tuned. Keep an eye on the Duolingo Facebook page. We will post more of these. Cindy and I wrote a blog post about to help with some tips for parents and teachers who are learning from home. Who are helping their kids learn from home. So you can go to it at home.duolingo.com if you want to quick access it. And keep sending us your questions. We're going to compile them, make sure we answer all of them across this period of working from home. And thank you, Cindy. I will see you next week.
Great. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.